Okay. So, this is a somewhat philosophical talk. Avi has got me interested over years in pseudo-randomness, and there's a sequence that I want to describe here and discuss in detail. How does this work? Like, we take 50 minutes and we take a break, right?
Yeah, if you want.
Yeah. I'm already bargaining for the break. Some of you who were, I gave a lecture on this 2 months ago at this small meeting at the department. I'd been writing up 3 lectures on this. I'd hoped to write lecture 2 and maybe go into it today, but I have had 0 time. So this will just be an elaboration on that. So for those who want to see more, you may be disappointed. Okay, so I want to discuss the Mobius function, mu of n. So if n and its randomness properties, so if n is p1 to the e1, e to the et, then mu of n is 0 if it's not square free n, so if any ej is greater than 2, and it's -1 to the number of prime factors otherwise. Now, arithmetic gives rise to randomness, arithmetic operations. I mean, my favorite example of that is if you look at the finite field Fp, and you look at x goes to, say, x inverse, which is looks very much like a random involution. So if you sort of order the elements 1 up to p, and then you look at the way these numbers come down, that's random. And that's a source of many things that we love in terms of expanders and pseudo-randomness there. And in these finite field situations, we have a certain conjecture that's true, which measures a certain aspect of the randomness, which we don't know here, which is what usually people would refer to as randomness in Mobius. So let me go through that. I have something quite different in mind here. But I want to just clarify that point. So this is a Mobius function, so it's a sequence 1, -1, -1, 0, so on, sequence of numbers which are 0, 1, and -1. And one could ask if the sequence is random. Of course, it's not random. I guess no deterministic thing is really random, but one might measure aspects of its randomness. And one reason that number theorists, at least people who are interested in the Riemann zeta function, are so interested in this is if the Riemann zeta function is what it usually is. I don't change that. It's God-given. And you're interested in the zeros of this function, then you might look at 1 over zeta of s. And then this will be the product over p of 1 minus p to the minus s, which is just some mu n, n to the minus s. So if you, this function is meromorphic. So if you're interested in the zeros of zeta, these will be the poles of this function. And it's clear that cancellation, just regular cancellation in the sum of mu of n, is probably connected with the zeros. And that's very easy to determine. In fact, the sum mu n, n up to n, which is going to be something that I'm going to be discussing a lot with some decoration here, but this is cancelling, so these numbers are random, so to speak, is equivalent elementarily, in fact, I won't go through it, but from this formula, it's kind of obvious if you know anything about zeta. The prime number theorem is a statement that the Riemann zeta function doesn't vanish on the line 1, or that this thing has no poles on the line 1. So it's, from that point of view, not at all surprising that this has a little bit of cancellation. Is it elementarily, so this is an elementary argument, equivalent to the prime number theorem. And if you push this argument a little further to see maybe further cancellation, in other words, some exponent in this cancellation, then, as is well known, the Riemann hypothesis, which is the statement that this function will have no poles in the real part of s bigger than 1/2, this will be equivalent to the sum mu n, n up to n. Well, you can put down something a little more accurate here. I'm going to discuss that in a second, but this is equivalent to this being n to the half plus epsilon for every epsilon positive. These are well-known equivalences, so you really would be happy if you were able to somehow understand why this has cancellation from another source rather than begging it from the zeta function. In any event, this is what we always call square root cancellation, because that's canceling to square root of the number of terms, and crudely, just like random numbers. So mu of n are numbers of modulus less than or equal to 1. There's a positive proportion of them where it's 0, actually. But this is just like random numbers. So that's the usual thinking in terms of Mobius randomness and Riemann and so on. But I just want to emphasize here that already here at this level, if you look finely enough, things will not be random. So the next term here is not random. So the next term. I mean, this is for all the computer scientists. Yeah. You're going to tell me what different notions of randomness are. I'm going to. I'm now going to explain. So, this thing here, if you use this function 1 over zeta of s and shift the contour and make sense of all this, it's not too difficult. This will be. The sum over the zeros you like to call this x rather than n, sum over the zeros of zeta of x to the 0 over the 0 times zeta prime at, I'll assume the zeros are on the line a half and say are simple, plus smaller terms, the trivial zeros, so that I'm just trying to understand what's true here. So the zeros are on the line a half here. So there's zeros here. There's zeros to the left, which are much smaller in magnitude. So if all the zeros are on the line a half, this would be an exponent of x to the half. So this would be x to the half times some sum like this, which is a function that morally we understand, assuming Riemann and assuming a little more. So if I took 1 over root x, mu of n, n up to x, then I claim this is a Besicovitch b squared almost periodic function. Of y, where e to the y equals x. This is the more natural variable.
Sorry, what is the assumption?
The assumption is Riemann plus simplicity of the zeros, more or less. That's about it.
This expression over there, what do you say about it?
I'm saying that this expression, which if these were really random numbers, you would have a law of iterated logarithm, is not true here. There's structure at this term, and the structure is an almost periodicity. Almost periodicity is no more, no less that the Riemann zeta function does have zeros. These frequencies determine this behavior. So it's very easy to see that this.
You can call it next distribution.
Well, the square root term. This is infinite. So this series here is not uniformly almost periodic. But it's in mean square almost periodic.
So
it's something called
the R term cannot be square root plus little r square root.
That's yeah, there is no next term square root, which is what he's saying. There's a distribution, but it's an almost periodic function. I love almost periodic functions, and we'll even allow almost periodic functions which are unbounded. They'll be squared almost periodic. This is exactly what this term is, which is highly non-random. So the random analogy breaks down at that point. All right?
What is this sum?
This is zero. My zeta and my rho look the same. Okay, rho. This in absolute value is infinite. Yeah, so there are enough zeros to make that. Has to be because the function's discontinuous. It's a nice observation. Yeah, we don't have to work out for that. All right. So this is the usual, and people have made models, and they've made, and Cromera's made models, and all these models have some features in connection with Riemann, but I don't want to discuss that here, even though that's certainly very, what? If you turn your microscope fine enough, as has been shown by Meyer and Friedland and Granville and people like that, all these models eventually will predict something if you look fine enough to be not random. Stochastic models of so if you put here, I'm just saying you can't treat mu of n as plus minus at random. So I'm not going to look at anything so fine, but I'm going to look at something much more telling. So what I want to discuss is what in Kowalski and Ivanich, which is now the standard text, got everything in their textbook, call the Mobius randomness principle. I want to make sense of it. It's something we use for heuristic arguments, but it turns out that one can actually make a lot of sense of this, and that's what this is all about. So I want to consider a sum of mu of n times another function, xi of n up to n. So this xi we're going to discuss a lot, where xi of n is bounded. I'll assume xi is not sparse and not too sparse in the sense that the only thing I'm going to discuss here, though in practice one usually will ask for more, is the question, is this little o of n? Well, of course it needn't be, xi may be mu. But the question is, for which xi's, I want to answer this question, for which xi's is this going to cancel? Can I describe this? And the Mobius randomness principle that they put forth in their book is that if xi is reasonable, it's the words, I'm quoting it. If xi is reasonable, by which I think they mean if xi were defined in any other way other than as mu of n itself, or something very close to it, if xi is reasonable, then that should cancel. And star should hold. In practice, when you're trying to actually use such principles to prove something, you usually want here at least n over log n to some power, rather than just little o. But I'm talking philosophically today. And any method that I will discuss later which gives something on this will usually give that extra little bit over log.
What's reasonable? I mean,
there's no definition of reasonable.
There's no definition?
No, they don't give. I'm going to give. I'm going to give a definition. The function 1 is reasonable. The function 1 is reasonable, and it's true. So any function given by a formula which is not involving the factorization of n might be considered reasonable, but there's no notion. No. Now, why would you want such a principle? There's no definition, there's no meaning. I'm going to give meaning by the end of today. I'll give you exact meaning. That's this lecture. It's to give meaning to it.
It's very similar to lots of things that are done in pseudo-randomness only in the situations in computer science where you usually start with a class of reasonable.
Yeah, right. So I've started with one guy.
Something.
Yeah.
Here you start
with one guy. Yeah.
Guy.
And I'm really interested in this one guy. That's. Yeah. And that, of course, makes, I can't start perturbing this guy and changing the thing. Yeah. Okay, so why are they so interested in this is, I just should, for people not in this field, whenever you want to count the number of primes, twin primes, primes of the form x squared plus 1, this principle will predict the answer on the nose, and it's never, ever let anybody down, as long as you've got a big nose to know when to use it. So reasonable means use it only when you feel like it's right. But why might it be used to count primes is if you look at the function lambda of n, which is log p, if n is a prime power. When I was a young man, I heard Enrico give a lecture, and he said, primes come with this weight whether you like it or not. You always, when you count primes, should weight by this. So this function has this property, and it's zero otherwise. So it's after Chebyshev and Riemann, we know that you should count prime powers. That's what's natural, certainly, in terms of many combinatorial formulae. So this function, you might be wanting to sum lambda n against xi of n, n up to n. You might be counting primes of some sort or something like that. And if you simply write, check the following identity, that lambda n is minus sum d divides n of mu of d of log d times log d. I'll let you check that. Then when you come to try apply this, lambda n xi of n, and you plug this in, you'll write n as dE, say, and then put what that is, you'll get a double sum. And then you switch your orders of summation, and you'll find that you always want to understand what mu does against your function or some relative of your function. And so the philosophy usually is that mu, this saying this principle is a reliable source of getting square root cancellation, while sums over primes are very unreliable. You can certainly predict incorrect asymptotics by trying to make models directly on the prime. So Mobius is very reliable in this sense. And there's a paper of Luo Ivanich and myself where we actually show that if you go even all the way up to square root with Mobius, you can be quite reliable, but not with other sums, especially of the type cosine root n, exactly root n times 2 pi, cosine 2 pi root n. So there are subtleties there, but the principle seems safe, and it's just used as a heuristic. Or when you can prove such things like this, it's used as a major device in proving theorems. Vinogradov's method, I'll return to this in a moment, is the main tool to try and understand something like this. And that's still the only tool. There are many modern treatments, but they all go back to that. All right, so the question is, how can one formulate this? Now, the way I've thought about this for a long time, and one way that I think I've picked up from this particular seminar when I come, would be to say, well, maybe star is true. Okay, so I'll just have my little dig at Avi here. Maybe star is true if xi is a simple function, xi is in P, xi is in polynomial. Let me make precise what that means. This is not looks crazy, but let's entertain it for a second. So by which I mean, I simply mean that you can compute, and I'll return when I start to describe cases of this that we can prove some of this complexity issue as far as I understand it. I mean we can compute xi of n for each n in polynomial log n steps. Okay, well, that's. I'm going to return to this in a second. Obviously, this is pre-assumes that you can't. Okay, so I don't have any counterexample to that. So the answer is I don't know.
But is computing the Mobius function as hard as
factoring? Factoring, okay, so it's not now. Firstly, let me say, I believe factoring is easy. I write I believe because in the literature, as I've discussed with Avi, it seems the literature, especially cryptography literature, including Shor's paper, which I looked at quite carefully, there's a statement that it is believed by everybody that factoring is hard. I don't think that comes from any scientific insight or anything. It's just that nobody's been able to factor quickly. So anyway, I believe that factoring, So this is going to be my way of dismissing this approach. It's not hard, it's easy. In other words, you can factor quickly. Don't say that. I will. Well, I suspect. Yeah, but maybe the mafia already knows how to factor and they're just keeping it secret. Okay. I can't keep my mouth shut, so you rest assured that I don't know how to factor quickly. But there's some people who are very secretive, but maybe they already know. I will give a simpler problem in a second. So I believe that factoring is easy, and in particular that mu is in P, which then means that this is not the right notion to understand the I'm trying to understand what kind of sequences are simple in the sense that they're going to cancel against mu. And this immediately, since as you point out. So to answer your question more explicitly, it is not known that you can compute this quickly. It's not known that it's hard as factoring. It's just not known.
It's quite interesting to find the smaller classes than P, for which is
right. So as you know, you can test if a number is prime, but that okay. So here's a problem for the seminar, which I tried and still can't do, but I don't think it's that hard. Can you cook up soap problem? That would also put to rest this notion that computational complexity is the right notion. Can you find xi in P, which correlates with mu in this sense? So the average value tends to alpha, let's say, positive. Question, I don't know. But this surely is much easier than that. You just have to do this. But of course, it means that you're finding a function which more or less is guessing what mu is some percentage of the time. That would be rather interesting by itself. So I don't know. And if you try pre-cook numbers by taking all the small numbers and then make smooth numbers which are positive proportion, the trouble is you have to cook. If you sort of pre-compute your numbers and multiply them out, if you just want to take log of n to a power numbers and then cook them up, you don't get a positive proportion, so you just miss. No, I said that. I said xi is not sparse. Summation mod xi n is bigger than a constant times n.
But tell me what, maybe I don't understand. If you take psi n to be lambda.
Yeah, that only gives, no, that's unbounded.
Unbounded.
Yeah. Unbounded. Xi is, yeah, very good. I've thought about this and I will pay up $100 for that. As stated, even if I've made a slip.
Unbounded.
Bounded and spot, not sparse. It's a good challenge. You will get, exactly. So I'm not bounded. Throughout, xi is bounded. Yeah. All right. So that's the. So I'm not going to. I just don't feel computational complexity is the right notion. Yeah. So I'm going to introduce a different way of looking at this, and I owe this to Furstenberg. So Furstenberg championed the following idea. So you could try to take a probabilistic, try to set up some process or something, but I'm going to take a view which is not invented by him, but certainly championed by him, which is a dynamic approach. And I want to explain it a bit. And I have no doubt that for some things, this is the right way to formulate this. Okay, so the paper I have in mind of Furstenberg, it's 1967, it's called Disjointness. And I'll tell you eventually what he's disjoint. He's got abstracts of theorems. What's remarkable about Furstenberg is he makes these abstract, soft definitions, and then after a long time with working this, comes up with a proof of similarity. So the philosophy there is quite different at some level to what I'm doing. As here we have a specific system. I think the philosophy there is whatever you're going to do better be true for every system, because he's going to be trying to prove something soft and general. But this system is one that I'm very interested in, and I want to put it into this context. So I will describe a bit later what his disjointness is. But the idea is to realize C of n. So I want to convert the problem of what the complexity of C is. Now, I don't know. Maybe there's you will tell me if there's a complexity analog of what we're going to do here. Let me go through this slowly. So we're going to realize Xn as the return times of a dynamical system. So could you look at the sky, and every time some comet comes by, it picks up Mobius for you when it comes through a specific set. Could then be an orbit so beautiful? Of course, if the system is simple and it's going to pick up Mobius, then we will start looking at it, because that system knows about other things too. So the question is how to formulate this and understand this. So, of course, you could try genuinely say a dynamical system, a Hamiltonian system, which may or may not be chaotic. And the issue of how complicated the system is exactly the way we're going to measure when this should be happening. Furstenberg does this abstract stuff, and I will follow it for a while here, because I think it's certainly the right language, even to formulate Vinogradov's method. So let me explain what this is. So a flow, I'm using his notation. I think terminology has changed since he calls the following a flow. So this is just an abstract thing like this. You have a compact space. You can think of it as a topological or metric space. And T, a map from X to X, continuous. This is definitely the setting in which I want to set this up. I don't want to relax anything here, otherwise it will become quickly meaningless. All right. And then, so we have the dynamics of T. So here's X. We have a point X naught. And we look at the orbit of X naught as we go through the positive integers. This needn't be invertible. I will get to that. Not yet. No. The main conjecture and the main thing that we're aiming for does not have that property, and that's very important. The minute you randomize with a measure, everything becomes trivial. So the minute you say almost all bets are off. There's no meaning to what I'm saying. So this is really the setting. Continuous, but the measure will be used to understand some other points, as you'll see. So if there's an invariant measure, and we will, of course, always have such things, and we might make use of them. All right, so we have its dynamics, and then we're going to take a set A, or a characteristic function of a set. Now, you might say it's not continuous, but just for the picture, let me pretend I take the characteristic function. And then I'm going to define C of n to be f of t to the n of some point x. So let x be a point in the space. Let f be a continuous function on x. Set this for n greater or equal to 1. So I call this a return time sequence. So C of n is a return. He doesn't quite call this, but I think this is the right terminology for this purpose. Notice, Enrico, it's a bounded function. Notice also it's potentially got the right density. All these are built into this. All right, so in this, the language of Furstenberg here is Xi is realized, the sequence Xi is realized in our flow F. So the flow is a pair XT, and when I want to measure, I'll put a third thing there, and it'll be called a process. That's what he calls it. Some people now call it a dynamical system with a measure. It's just, I'll stick to his notation. So Xi is realized in this flow. So the idea is a very simple one, and that's really his philosophy, is let's try realize Xi in the simplest dynamics that I can realize it. So of course, Xi may be realized in many different dynamics. And of course, if you realize Xi in a complicated dynamics, then you don't want to use that dynamic. So maybe Xi is the constant function, then X is a point. That would be in the simplest dynamics of all. If C is realized in a simple dynamics, then you have a good chance, maybe, of converting the question of when this is true to a question about the properties of the dynamics. All right, so C, say we want to realize our sequence in the simplest dynamics in which it occurs in this sense. In other words, in which it occurs for some point x and for some function f. Now, you can always realize any sequence in the following dynamics. And these are not the dynamics in which we are able really to prove that much, but they are related, very related to the cases we can. So suppose xi is finite value. Otherwise, you have to make a slightly more elaborate construction. So xi of n is in 0, 1. That's rich enough for everything we're doing anyway. Then you could take 0, 1 to the integers, this topological space, which is compact with a product topology. There's a natural shift. So when, I guess the Morse lectures are today, this Morse was the first to really parameterize dynamical systems by sequences of coding like this, which are called Morse sequences. And this, I'm setting it up so I have an obvious coding. So there's a shift. This is just the shift to the right. In other words, if I have xn, my sequence, then the new sequence after applying t is xn plus 1 and greater than equal to 1. So, so I'm shifting the sequence to the left. Notice this is not invertible. And this is kind of important for my whole discussion here, because Mobius, I don't want to make it even, and I don't want to make a left-handed Mobius. So I'm not invertible, but this is harmless as far as I can see. It hasn't seemed to hurt anything. OK, so this is a shift. It's continuous. And if we take the point xi, if we take the sequence, I'll call it omega, which is xi1, xi2. That's a point inside x. So this looks like abstract nonsense, and it is, but it's useful. So I take this point inside the space x. I take the function f of x equal x1, the first coordinate. This is a totally disconnected space, so it's continuous, this function. I just take the first projection on the first coordinate. And then t moves me to the right each time. So as I read, so if I look at the sequence, I move to the left, I just recover the sequence. So in other words, c belongs to this flow f, which is the shift x with t through this realization. In other words, t to the f, this f of t to the n of omega is xi of n. So every sequence can be realized this way. There's no loss in generality of thinking it dynamically. What it throws is this transformation t and what's happening inside here as measuring the complexity of the sequence. All right. Of course, you should immediately remark, and we will do such a thing, is there's no reason, suppose I take this point here, there's no reason for me to use the whole shift. The whole shift is a very complicated system. It's Bernoulli. It's massively complicated. There are points there of arbitrary. You can prescribe any sequence for that. So clearly, if I want to find the simplest place where xi is realized, at least at this moment, I should stick to the closure of that point inside the space. So in fact, and this is an important construction for later, in fact, xi is realized in the following. Let's call it fxi, this smaller system, which consists of x, xi, and the shift, where the compact topological space of all shifts, x is replaced by x, xi, is simply the closure in x of the sequence t to the n of omega. So in this picture, I have omega And of course, this sequence, nobody said that it's dense in the whole space. If it's dense in the whole space, Mike C is pretty complicated, as you'll see in this, and star will definitely be false. So we take the closure of this. Maybe the closure is a much simpler closed set. The transformation preserves that, that's trivial. And then Xi belongs to this potentially simpler system, and it's sort of the smallest system in which, in the shift setting, in which we can realize our sequence. All right, I think you probably know now what I'm trying to do. I'm trying to recast question one in terms of dynamics, so I need to understand which dynamics are complicated and which are not. And just like in complexity theory and information theory, here too, the right notion is entropy. That will become clear as I go along here when I explain some theorems and a conjecture which whose truth I believe because it follows from a more standard conjecture. So that's the reason I believe entropy is right here. For a long time, I was confused about this point. And it's precisely connected with the fact that this is a purely topological setup. And I'll explain this. All right, so the complexity of Xi. So I'm going to define the complexity of Xi to be the complexity of the simplest dynamical system it appears in. So what's the complexity of our flow? Okay, and this is called topological entropy. Let me tell you what it is. So there's no measure yet, and this is critical. So the topological entropy of a flow, F, is an abstract definition. Topological entropy is a measure, is the measure of the exponential, so entropy always measures exponential growth of something, exponential growth rate of the number of distinct orbits. Let me assume it's a metric space. It's, of course, not relevant here when I make this. Well, let me make that clear. You could make a formal definition with partitions, but let me just draw a picture. This particular interpretation is due to Bowen, and that's the one that I think is most intuitive. All right, so given n and epsilon positive, given two numbers which are positive, epsilon small, n will be very large. You try to measure the number of distinct orbits of length n, epsilon distinct orbits of length n, and measure the exponential growth rate of that. So given n and epsilon positive, let n and epsilon be the maximum number of epsilon n distinct orbits. So what do I mean by an epsilon? The two orbits being distinct over a period of n. So I have x in my space x and y in my space x. Then I look at x, tx up to tnx. And I look at y, ty, up to T N Y. Of course, the space is compact. They're going to have to start getting close to each other. So I say that these two orbits are epsilon apart if there's at least one time when they are epsilon apart. So the tube around them actually are distinct, epsilon tube. So I assume the space is a metric space. So this is some number.
You're counting the maximum number of points for each time.
Yes. And you can state in terms of subcovers of open covers, so you don't need a metric space. That's how it was originally defined. This notion is due to Adler, Konheim, and somebody else whose name I forget. Ah, yeah. What? Thank you. Thank you. And this was defined after the notion of Kolmogorov and Sinai, which is measure entropy, which I'll say a word about in a second because it'll be important. All right, then you take the limit, maybe take the lim sup, but some of these limits exist by certain simple arguments. So you fix epsilon, and then you take the limit as epsilon tends to zero, limit n this in this order of log of n epsilon n over n. And this is a number h, and that's the entropy. It's well defined. E, I'll take it to the. Yeah, I'll take always the base E. Is that what you're asking me? Yeah, log is the base E.
No.
All right, what's going to be important is whether this is positive or not. So it won't matter what base I choose.
Do you have any idea what is the topological entropy of the Möbius function in its. Yeah.
It's the highlight of the lecture. I'm going to prove it. I'm going to prove something about it. It's a hot. Okay, good. Yeah, yeah. I'm going to give you many examples. When? Okay. So just this. So this is the topological entropy. It's obviously very hard to compute if you don't say something what your system is. But if you have a concrete system, people compute these if they're homogeneous systems. I'm going to give you a slew of them, which are going to be critical for us, all of zero entropy, because I now want to state, I want to lead up to the main fundamental conjecture, which I'm very confident about, and which allows you to unify, and I'll explain. So F is deterministic, and I want to explain this word, because it's a funny word. And it has a meaning, and I spent the summer learning some of this ergodic theory, and I was perplexed by this for a while until it was explained to me in some book. So F is deterministic means it's got zero entropy, which seems all right. And that's just another name for zero entropy. But why the word determinism? Okay, so I want to explain this because I'll be using it anyway. If our flow F also has, and one could then, the minute I put this, I can relax my continuous functions to measurable ones, but let me not do that right now. Also has an invariant, or Borel, so everything's defined on open sets and the sigma algebra connected with the open sets. By the way, when I come to complexity here, there's a point where I want to later tell you whether these things are of complexity class P or not, certain systems. And for that, I think you really have to distinguish whether you're working over the real numbers, as I've been setting it up, or not. And there's one definition that you showed me that is the one that's appropriate, in my opinion. So I'll get back to that. Okay. If F also has an invariant measure, nu, defined on the open sets, on the Borel sets, for T invariant measure, i.e., T inverse, nu of T inverse of any set A is nu of A. You must do T inverse because T wasn't invertible necessarily for all A. Borel sets are just Borel measurable. So suppose we have this extra property that there's an invariant measure, then the triple. So this is more information and very useful information. This is a setting in which you have Poincaré recurrence, you have ergodic theory. You have powerful tools which are just glorifications, in my view, of the pigeonhole principle, but real great glorifications of the principle. Because the theorem produced results which you would say, how can such an abstract theory produce Semmeretti's theorem? Well, it does, because there is structure just to this triple. So this is where ergodic theory takes place. So I'll call it F nu. And it's a triple which has got the set XF. I'll always assume my space is a topological space transformation T. They've got some special names for this. And an invariant measure nu. Now, there can be many, there are typically many invariant measures nu which are invariant under such a T. They can be singular with respect to each other. We pick up, say, some invariant measure. And we get now a flow with this extra measure. And this Furstenberg in this paper. Papers divided into two. The first is about flows, and the second about, well, maybe it's the other way around, the second about processes. So F nu, he called. So now we can start thinking of ergodic theory and probability theory. So f nu is a process. And for a process, or an ergodic system, it needn't be ergodic. I won't define ergodic yet. One has h f nu, which is now the Kolmogorov-Sinai entropy of this process. So h f nu is so Shannon, as you guys know, Shannon's entropy from information theory, it was realized by Kolmogorov and Sinai that you could import those ideas into definitions to make an invariant of a dynamical system which has a measure as well. This had no measure. Okay? So HF nu is the Kolmogorov-Sinai entropy. It's defined in a similar way to this. I won't write it down. It's defined in terms of partitions, which have this kind of definition. The only difference is instead of counting the number of different tubes like this, you weight it by the Shannon entropy function minus P log P in the definition. So it's an average of the same definition as before, but average with respect to your measure nu. So you have the atoms and you compute the measure of those separate atoms after iterating n times and looking at all possible intersections.
So what do you weight here? You just pick the sort of
the worst
epsilon net of points that are different.
Okay, so what you have to do is you have to take a partition of the space, a measurable partition. So this subject's much easier than that, than topologic. Topological dynamics is much harder because you have continuous functions. It's very hard to start changing things. When you have a measurable function, you can start taking characteristic functions of sets. You have much more freedom in defining isomorphisms and things like that. And what you do is you take a partition of the space, and then you iterate T inverse n times and take all possible intersections, and you take the standard entropy of that probability distribution, and the logarithmic growth rate, exponential growth rate, is called the entropy. And it's an invariant. That's sort of the big observation of Sinai and Kolmogorov. Now, the interesting thing is, I want to point this out because in terms of Mobius and something that will be with it, the notion of deterministic is a very good word in this context. So it's a fact, which is not difficult. This is a standard fact from entropy theory. By the way, there's a beautiful book, absolutely beautiful book, which discusses all these notions. It's by Glasner. Apparently there are two Glasners. What's his name? The father. The father. Okay. What's his first name? No, I think it's. Okay. Yes. Okay. I don't know which is which. All right. By S. Glasner. It's a beautiful book, which discusses entropy, discusses topological dynamics, discusses a passage between the topological dynamics and measure dynamics. But in the measure category, a fact, I think it's due to the same Pinsker. There's something called the Pinsker fact. It's the same Pinsker who made it, the first to make expanders. A fact is that Kolmogorov-Sinai entropy is zero if and only if for all xi's, for all our functions, xi's and points, for all xi's. Now we're talking almost everywhere, because for all xi's coming from our process, from f nu, xi1 is a measurable function. Of xi2, xi3, and so on. That is, if you know what the tail is, you know the beginning with probability 1. So that's why it's called deterministic, the obviously right word. The process, if you know the future, if it's invertible, if you know the future, you know the past. Anyway, this is not invertible, so I just state it this way.
So measurable function, this is a function of the real, right?
And if you know all those numbers, then with probability 1, you can predict what the first number is. And this, of course, will not be topologically so. as you're going to see in the Mobius has this in spades. All right, so that's where the word deterministic comes. But the important thing to me is the notion of topological entropy, and I'll call a sequence. So now a sequence will be called deterministic. So you can see where I'm heading. Let me one more remark here, which is a simple consequence of the convexity of the entropy function, is that hf nu is less than or equal to hf. So this might even be obvious to you, that when I put a probability measure which weights these by some distribution, while the topological guy will just try and make the biggest guy. So the supremum of all the measure entropies over all new invariant measures is the topological entropy. So the topological entropy, if you have positive topological entropy, does not mean you have positive measure entropy for something that you might be interested in. So these are, I mean, there are many invariant measures, but there's only one. Sometimes there's a unique maximal one. I don't know in the Mobius if this is true, as you'll see. All right, so I can now state the main conjecture and talk a bit around it. So Xi is deterministic. So a sequence is deterministic if Xi can be realized in a deterministic flow. So this is the notion of simple. And the conjecture, which I didn't believe for a long time, but now I'm absolutely confident, you'll see why.
This is about topological.
Yeah, only about. Yeah, let me point out, you can't make, if you start saying, so I have a discussion of this in my notes. If you allow yourself the notion of random x relative to a measure mu, then you can prove that it doesn't matter what the dynamics of the system is, for almost all x you will be canceling against Mobius, but that's because you've randomized on x. I want every x, and this is absolutely critical in applications and in understanding this.
So then you will not necessarily take the minimal system because the x's you picked were picked after you picked mu. You looked at the.
Okay, I will. Let me state the conjecture, and I'll explain how I'm going to measure progress towards it and why it's true. And then I will make a Mobius system which will explain it in terms of disjointness. That's a plan. But so this is a basic conjecture that star, is it still up there? All right, summation mu n xi n cancels. So given c deterministic, if you can realize xi in a deterministic flow, then this is true. This is close to if and only if, but it's actually, I haven't understood Bergin's counterexample, but he's convinced me that it's probably not if and only if. It really wants to be if and only if. Yeah.
Do you have an example of a non-deterministic?
Yeah, I'm going to give you, I'll give you, you want examples, I'm going to give you examples. Of a system which is non-deterministic?
No, is it easy to find a specific sequence that's not deterministic?
Well, I'm not computing anything. So if I take the full shift.
No, just a single.
You can realize mu itself, right? It showed you how to realize any sequence. You can realize.
But you want a seriously non-deterministic system.
No, I mean, you think a sequence is deterministic if it's realizable by.
Right. So if I'm going to show you, okay, the following theorem will be my main example. You'll love it. Okay, so let me state theorem. This is, and I want to explain the proof of it eventually in some form. Mu of n is not deterministic. I should have answered that immediately. Yeah, that's highly non-trivial. Mu is not deterministic. This is the first theorem about the randomness in Mobius.
Ask if it's easy to build an example of a sequence that's not deterministic.
Okay, so if you take a sequence in a shift, and suppose the closure of that sequence, the full shift has got positive entropy.
No.
The full shift has got all possible sequences it's got full entropy. If it's on two letters, it'll be 2 to the n, it'll be log 2 will be the. Okay, so if you have a sequence, a subshift, like I had defined there, and if the entropy is positive, then the original sequence is not deterministic. You can't realize it in any simpler system because the topological entropy is an invariant.
Almost every sequence.
Almost every sequence
is fine, but
right.
The specific one.
Well, I'm very proud. Mobius, it's probably the first one of the state. No, actually, that's not true. When you see I prove it, you'll see I'm proving it by a little device. And there's, of course, something which is allowing me to prove it. OK, so let me state that because I like that. So theorem. I'll try actually show you where that comes from. Mu of n is not deterministic. This is a statement about. This is the first and pretty much only statement I know about the randomness of Mobius. Per se. So you can't realize a simple system. You can't realize Mobius in a zero entropy system. But I want to explain that. I want to break this conjecture into pieces. Because this conjecture can succumb to. You can measure progress on this conjecture, which is my main interest in it. So this is a continuation of the conjecture, which is just a breakdown. Mu is orthogonal, I don't know what I called it, or disjoint from A. So mu is orthogonal to every sequence from, so I'm saying the same thing again, every zero entropy flow or every deterministic flow. Why is this? It's no different to that, but now I can start talking about different flows for which we can prove this conjecture. And I'm going to actually tell you we can prove this conjecture for very many flows of zero entropy. And then I need to give you examples of zero entropy flows, which I will, and ones for which we can prove it. So I'm going to go through that, but that's this breaking it down this way is the way to try attack that is to try to do it flow by flow, to build up more complicated flows and prove the conjecture. So the status, as you will see, is this conjecture is probably very hard. I haven't told you why I believe it. In fact, when I was showing this to Elon Lindenstrauss for the longest time, he kept on trying to give me counterexamples. But it's definitely true. Because zero entropy systems can be very, very nasty. We'll only be able to prove it at this point in certain kinds of zero entropy systems that I'm going to explain. And I'd hope to have many more before this lecture, but I'll just explain what we know. Let me explain before I take a break why this conjecture is probably true. It gives me some confidence, other than the fact that the real progress in this is every time you prove this for a more complicated F, you've proved. So there are two sources of randomness in mu that we can actually prove: this theorem and anything which will establish this for simple flows. Now, from this point of view, I want to explain why didn't we take the high road, which is a much simpler road? It's just that you hit a block. You hit this big wall as you try. So there's a conjecture. So let me clarify this. So there's a nice conjecture of Chawla, which is not as well known as it might be, because I think only because no progress has ever been made on it. So if no progress is made on it, nobody can write anything about it. But it certainly rings true. Only problem is if you go where this is only stated, he's got a lovely little book called The Riemann Hypothesis and Hilbert Tenth's Problem. And in the book, he makes this conjecture and he puts big O instead of little O. So I can prove his conjecture. It's a rather horrible misprint. And that is that why not forget about all these other systems? I brought all these Xs that I want to see that are simple and Mobius is random, sufficiently random to not know about them. That's what we're trying to understand here. You should ask me, what is happening with Mobius with itself? Maybe I can correlate Mobius with itself. Well, of course, if I could correlate Mobius with itself, I should know pretty much anything I want to, and that's this conjecture. So the conjecture is given, I'll state it in a slightly souped-up version so that I can use it. I'm maybe you could drop this, but
this
yeah. So let k1, k2, up to kt be in 0, 1, not all 0. So there's at least one of them that's 1. a1 less than a2 less than at. Give me finite number of integers. Then consider n up to n of Mobius of n plus a1, n plus a2, n plus at. And the conjecture is this little o n. So you fix k1, excuse me, let me take it to powers k1 up to kt. So the k is just to restrict to be square free when I feel like it, when I want to put the zeros. Probably you can drop that, but that's not the important point. The important point, there has to be some random guy here, one guy which is trying to be plus or minus 1. The zeros, of course, are not important in this kind of statement. So there should be a guy which is plus or minus 1, so at least one of these k's is not 0. Then he conjectures this cancels. And he conjectures for some other function called lambda also. Well, this is a fantastic conjecture, and it looks right. I mean, this is telling you that Mobius, if you have a number n and you look at n plus a1, you really don't know about the sign of the number of prime factors if they are square free, both of them. That's measuring some randomness, some lack of correlation. They are uncorrelated.
Why do you have some k to be 0?
If they're all 0, then they can't be cancellation. That's so I just said. So as to restrict these to be square free because of what I want to state next, and I didn't want to, I'm going to make this conjecture. So this conjecture implies my main conjecture. So that's why I believe that conjecture. Nobody's ever questioned that conjecture, but nobody's ever proved any instance of this unless there's only one variable, in which case it's a prime number theorem.
No,
no, these are distinct.
Yeah.
Zero means one.
Yeah.
To square free. Yeah. Just for, because when I make this reduction. Okay, so this main conjecture, which has the big advantage, is that we can do, so the moral of the story is that zero progress has ever been made on this sort of a brick wall. And the moral of the story is you can't correlate Mobius against, you can't correlate Mobius against something that's itself complicated. We just don't have the tools to do that.
Yeah, but even for t equals 2, it's as difficult
right.
as twin primes.
It's as difficult as twin primes. 2 and the k tuple primes would be there. So this is wide open and maybe even more difficult, I'm not sure. But it depends whether twin primes means infinitely many or the asymptotics. It's close to the asymptotics, yeah. So this is a very hard problem. And the whole point of making some conjecture like this is that one can. So the moral of the story is we have techniques to correlate mu against simple functions. And this conjecture is just about correlating against simple functions. But the more complicated that you make the xi, still of zero entropy, the more you are learning about the Mobius function. And each time you prove a theorem like that, it usually has massive consequences in prime number theory, most notably Vinogradov. All right, so that's maybe a good place to stop there. I will not give the proof. The proof that this implies that is purely, absolutely combinatorics. It's got nothing else but combinatorics. And it's true in the setting of continuous functions there. And the reason I wanted to always state this purely in terms of topological is precisely because you can't randomize on a measure. And if you're going to talk about every point, everything has to be continuous. And that part is the part that the part that's maybe suspicious here, or was suspicious to Elon, for example, is he said to me that if you have just a topological system, which is zero entropy, the distribution of the points can be very, very bad. And he gave me very bad examples. Well, if Chow is true, Mobius will always beat. Zero entropy cannot fight Mobius if Chow is true. Mobius is that random. That's the bottom line. All right, so I think I'll take a 5-minute break, and then I will outline what we know towards this conjecture, which is what I've been working on, and then I'll introduce a system which I think is very pretty, which will allow me to prove this and understand dynamically what this means. So that'll follow from the system. In analytic number theory, for which progress has been made, and this was a topic of one of our mini courses that many of you didn't come to. So if C of n is multiplicative, so of course, if I take mu of n, it's multiplicative. But if I take mu of n plus 1, I'm dead. That's no longer multiplicative. Multiplicative means C of n is multiplicative. That is, C of n m is C of n, or even if they're just relatively prime, which is completely multiplicative or fully multiplicative. So if your sequence happens to have this extra property, then summing C of n against mu of n, which is now a multiplicative function, is well understood whether this is going to be little o of n. It's connected in that case to the theory of zeta and L functions. And this sound had explained some of this, the work of Halash, but the theorem that I'll mention here is due to Wirsing. So just so that you know that there are theorems in the subject which allow you to see this cancellation, but not if the thing, if I shift, I'm dead with this analysis, and that's the thing. So this, in this case, C can also be complicated. So suppose that it's actually real valued and between minus 1 and 1 and multiplicative, then Wirsing, completing some conjecture of Erdős and Wintner, proved that star is true. One plus C of P over P summed over primes. So obviously that allows you to go down to primes, should allow you to go down to primes, and this series diverges. Now notice this is no longer cancellation. This is a positive series. So it's a complete characterization. So of course the big issue here with this conjecture is whether there's cancellation against Xi. And the answer is if and only if Xi wants to look like minus 1 a lot of the time. How much so that this diverges? If it's minus 1 a lot of the time, it's looking like Mobius. So that's the only sort of theorem that exists in the literature which allows you to correlate two things, but they both have to be multiplicative. The minute you shift or you multiply, you do change a little bit, or you take something more general, then we don't know how to correlate two complicated things. I should also say, while Bergen has this counterexample, I have never understood it. And it's quite complicated. There is a theorem of Weiss, which is very pretty, and which indicates that this is almost if and only if. And somehow, if you generalize it a little bit, it will be if and only if. This is Benji Weiss. And that is, if you have x, a subshift, meaning it's in this shift subspace, a closed subset of 0, 1 to the n under the translation. So flow f is a subshift. And suppose h of f is positive. So suppose I've got positive topological entropy. For measure entropy, there are beautiful classification theorems of Ornstein, most notably, that if you have a K system with positive entropy, it's completely classified by its entropy. So this entropy turns out to be pretty much in positive entropy and invariant once you factor out the zero entropy part. But in the topological setting, which is absolutely necessary for our understanding because we want every point, the understanding is much weaker. But this is a theorem which goes in the right direction in that it says that if the topological entropy is positive, then there's a positive density subset of the integers, such that if you restrict your sequences to this positive density subset, you get all possible sequences of zeros and ones. So it looks like a full shift, but on this positive density subset. So it restricts to, so this is why there's positive entropy. Quite remarkable, and it's proved by a very clever combinatorial theorem that goes back to Schellach, believe it or not. So you recognize. Okay, so a subset of n then such that there's a positive density of such that the sequences in our space, in our closed set, restrict to all sequences on the subset. So it's positive density, which means that when you try to sum mu of n against that xi of n, you can make xi of n be minus mu of n, or mu of n, at every one of this positive density subset, which will then make this have a big, large value. But Bergin's example, if it's correct, is going to come and cancel that out. So I've never understood how that's going to work. Anyway, I don't know how important the if and only if is, which is why I'm not pushing that point. All right. So now,
didn't Chalice's conjecture say that mu will cancel against shifted powers of mu? So those aren't deterministic, aren't they?
What? Shifts of powers of Mobius. Yeah, no, Chawla is telling you that he's telling you more. But if I take the, remember that to, the sequence, which is mu of n, I have proved, you will see, is not deterministic. So when you take the closure of that sequence, you'll get bad sequences.
His question was, the other direction doesn't, not one xi.
Sorry, I understand your question. The question is, can there be a system of positive entropy such that every sequence cancels against Mobius? That's the way my conjecture is really to break it down into one system at a time. Can there be a sequence of so is it true that the minute F has positive entropy, then every sequence, there is a sequence in there which won't correlate against Mobius? And the answer is, I would like that to be if and only if. It's very close to being if and only. Once you have positive entropy, there's a bad sequence. That's what I believe.
If you take xi to be a multiplicative function such that the sum over the prime diverges,
yeah,
then you release it as a deterministic.
Well, if it's 1, minus 1. I don't know. I can't think of my feet that far. Sorry. I don't know. I will think about that afterwards. I don't know. All right. So what do we so the main conjecture, so the main conjecture, the main tool, if f is a point, that's where we started. Then this is just the prime number theorem. The conjecture is just the prime number theorem. If f is finite, that means xf is a finite system, just a periodic system. Yeah, and this is equivalent to Dirichlet's theorem. So these cases are known. All right, so we want to build something that's serious. And the most important technique is due to Vinogradov. And he proved the following. So Vinogradov, and this particular theorem is due to Davenport, showed that the conjecture is true. They don't call this language, of course. Conjecture is true for the following system, which is just the circle with rotation. Every system I'm going to put up now is zero entropy. Otherwise, it's basically not true, is what I'm saying. So I'm going to build up the conjecture by trying to build it up for all zero entropy systems. Now, I don't know what the worst zero entropy system is, so I'll just go through sort of critical cases and cases where we have the tools. So conjecture is true for the following system. F is the circle, and T alpha is a rotation by any number alpha, including rational. But if it's rational, it's a periodic system. So that case we already know. So this is the case where x goes to x plus alpha in R of z, which is S. Circle. And this means that if you take summation mu n fn alpha n up to n, and Vinogradov introduced this to handle this in the context of the circle method, so he gets a slightly better bound here. This is little o n. And you prove this by first just doing it for a dense set of continuous functions. So the Davenport theorem is quite nice and uniform. And this is Davenport's version. You can even put a log on the other side independent of alpha, which is quite powerful. I forget the exact thing. It's n over log n to some power. Uniformly in alpha, actually. But we, of course, have a fixed alpha. And then this is just saying that the conjecture is true for such a system F, which is a rotation of a circle. E to the 2 pi I. You haven't been at all the lectures in this video. I'm kidding. Okay. So now I'm going to say a word about his method, because that I should at least explain something about. But I claim that his method is ideally suited to dynamics, as you'll see in a second.
In this statement, that is true for every F.
Yes, any continuous. Yeah. The conjecture is true for F, a rotation, a finite set, and a point. And now, the most general thing which is, now the rotation is simple for many, by the way, rotation has zero entropy. Okay, otherwise the conjecture, you would be, you're asking for examples with zero entropy. What happens with a rotation is here's x, x plus alpha. If I take y and y plus alpha, the distance will be the same. It won't change. That dynamics is very, it's acting isometrically. So there are only three possible differences. Good exercise. So this is an extremely simple dynamics. Zero entropy. That's trivial. I will get back to the complexity of sequences defined in more complicated homogeneous systems in a second, because that's where the action is. And I'll explain a little bit about his method, but
the exact real value as opposed to the Borel.
This uses a sieve. Yeah, there's a sieve and a very important tool of bilinear forms, which I'm going to explain what its dynamical import is. Right, so this was a major breakthrough of Vinogradov, and it's the means by which, his breakthrough by which he was able to prove that every odd number is a sum of three primes. You mean discontinuous function?
Yeah.
I think it's probably, I'm sure it's okay. I don't think that'll be a problem. Yeah, I'm sure it's okay. I mean, because the limit measure is continuous, I think you can cut off with small measure on the side. Yeah, it shouldn't be a problem. But I want to stick with continuous functions. And I like this all and every and F. Yeah, it's certainly true. That's okay. So more generally, and we'll see some of these, they're naturally built into our study of Mobius anyway. So more generally, any isometric thing like this, so more generally, what's called the equicontinuous family, or the conjectures true for a Kronecker flow, which I'll define now. So these are the simplest flows which are zero topological entropy. And they are just generalizations of this rotation of a circle. The next thing would be rotation of a torus. And you could even go to an infinite torus. So G, a compact group. Since I'm looking at powers of an element, you can assume it's a compact abelian group. And you'll see some of these coming up naturally. So you might think I'm abstracting here for no good reason. They built into Mobius. A compact factor, a Kronecker factor, is married to the Mobius, as you will see. So if you take a compact abelian group and you take the system G, that's the set, and TG, so TG of X is G times X. There's standard character theory of a compact abelian groups. It'll quickly reduce to this thing here. So you prove it. So it reduces to Vinogradov. The next most complicated zero entropy systems, and I mentioned them here because this is in a way where I started and where Ubers and I got involved.
It's
trivial.
No.
If I start with a point and I take powers of an element, the closure of that will be in a abelian group. I'm not allowing, there's only one element.
Just,
so it's always, so you can start in a bigger group, but you never exit the abelian, the torus. Yep. So it sounds sexier to say any group, but you've suddenly said nothing. Okay, so that's the isometric case. And then the next most basic case, and this is a case that I think is ripe, and Leo and I are working on this, and I was hoping to maybe announce some serious completion of this, but right now it's just examples. Distal flow. So let me tell you, the next these are zero entropy, and these have a classification, and they are the next most complicated after this, and they are of great interest, of course, null flows that everybody seems interested in. Are examples of this. So a distal flow means that, like here, the distance between those points remained constant. So whatever we did, we started with x and y, and then we remained the constant distance. Suppose the points never get close. That's distal. So if the inf, so given x, y, in the space for the flow, if the inf over n greater or equal to 1 of the distance from t to the n x, t to the n y is positive, x not equal to 1. So suppose you take two points and they're not equal, and then the whole orbit never gets close to each other. So somehow this should be, this is, it's a theorem, this has zero entropy. It's not completely obvious, this has zero entropy. You may think it's obvious, but it's not. It's a theorem of Parry. So this is the definition. These are of zero entropy. This is the definition of distal. Okay, exercise. Show any null sequence so this means that so this is going to be the generalization to a null group of the Kronecker flow. So this is really just an extension of a torus, but it's a it's quite non-trivial. So n is a null group, null potent group. When Green was talking here a few weeks ago, he always, everybody gives this example. So this x, y, z, and r. So this is not abelian, but it's two-step null potent. So let's look at the n with the real entries. So these numbers are real. And then I look at n with the integer entries. That's a discrete subgroup, and this quotient, of course, is easy to determine, just like with a circle. X will go between 0 and 1, Y will go between 0 and 1, Z will go between 0 and 1, but of course the multiplication is not abelian. So this is the space, so the flow is F, X, F, T, G, where X, F is this space, this is the topological space. So now we're talking about genuine, nice systems, okay? This is a homogeneous. These are the homogeneous distal flows. They're not equicontinuous, so they're not Kronecker flows. XF looks like this, and the transformation is TG applied to a point NZ times X. Coset is you multiply on the right NZ X times G. Then you iterate. So this is an example. These are distal. Any null flow like this, or null sequence. So in the terminology of Host and Krah, if you take a point inside that space and a function on the orbit, that's called a null sequence. And This has been a very important example in the general case of null manifolds. So these are distal. So this is your exercise. Show that the points never get close. It's a simple exercise. So this has a nice history in terms of, this is in fact where Ubis and I started talking about this. Green gave a lecture on this maybe 1.5 years ago here, right in this room, where he explained that he and Tao were able to, what in my language here, prove that the conjecture is true for a null flow. The techniques are very close to Vinogradov. They just require equidistribution in this null manifold, which required a certain uniformity, which is the harder work, and then an application of Vinogradov's methods, which I'll say a word about. It's quite a bit more complicated than the torus, but it's still a very simple dynamical system. And the correct thing here, I think that one can prove using the techniques of Vinogradov for all distal flows. But I certainly haven't done that. But I've done certainly some non-homogeneous examples of distal flows for which a conjecture is true. Just to make clear that each time you prove something like this, it's usually because there's some quite striking application. So knowing the orthogonality or the disjointness of Mobius with some specific system F, like Vinogradov used it in the circle method, and for Green and Tao, this is the critical input, one of the many inputs in their theory of linear equations in primes. So it is a remarkable fact that the generalization of the circle method, which you can see the circle in here, it's in front of your eyes, but if you go to systems of linear equations, it's really a discovery of Weiss and Furstenberg in the context of Samaretti, that null manifolds, the kind of factors of the systems that they have to analyze, can be studied completely if they understand just null manifolds. And null manifolds are the right generalization of rotation of the circle. So for me, who comes from the circle method, or at least I knew the circle method first. The circle method, if you try to do systems of linear equations, you would use a torus. And that just is too expensive in any kind of analysis that we're familiar with. And so what these, particularly Furstenberg, has discovered, and then Host and Krah, and Green and Tao, is that this null manifold replaces that, and at some point this is a critical ingredient there, just like it was with Vinogradov. So these cases, each time you prove this, it's very interesting. So I won't go into the distal case, because we don't have, that's one of the things I was hoping to be able to say, a complete theorem about them, other than examples. But let me point out why the distal case has a very good chance of being handled. And that is because the distal, there's a characterization of distal flows by an inductive procedure. You start with a point, and you take an isometric extension of this. So basically, all distal flows are gotten by not products of distal flows. You start off with a simple distal flow. So maybe here you have a distal flow x, and maybe here on y you have a fiber. And what you're doing is on this, the transformation takes me from x to tx. And that's your distal flow about which you might have already established some Vinogradov kind of estimate. And then on the fiber, so it's not a product situation, but for each x, there's a, let's say, rx, which is a rotation. So the fiber is going to be a group. And you've got a rotation in the fiber which varies from x to x, from point to point. So you move from x to tx, and then y goes to rx times y. So it's a skewed product, not an ordinary product, like a semi-direct product. And those R is some function, just some measurable a continuous function from the x space into the isometries of y. So if you think,
like semi-direct product.
It's exactly generalizing semi-direct product. And you can build all of them like this. So you have a very good chance of inductively pushing through Vinogradov's method when I explain to you one word about it. All right, the critical case in my view, and this is a case where I'm afraid it's much harder. So what's the next most complicated zero entropy system for which number theory is intimately connected, and knowing this sort of thing would be very useful? And that's to replace the group. Okay, and here I want to talk quickly about a complexity issue. Is the only other homogeneous systems, so I don't have a clue what the most, so the conjecture was about any flow of zero entropy, but I would be happy to stop at this critical case. And I want to explain why that this case is much harder. And that the ingredients are, when I explain a word about Vinogradov's method, much, much more sophisticated. At least that's how it looks at this point. And that is to replace this group by a semi-simple group and that by a lattice, but still to have zero entropy. So let me tell you where these are born. So let's call this the Ratner case. I'll explain why. This is the genuine Ratner case. So let me take G as SL2R, and the discrete group is SL2Z. All right. So our space G mod gamma is not compact, but that's a minor point. But just I warn you, not compact. And then you take G mod gamma, that's my space XF. I'm defining for you a flow. So I take this as the space, and now I take G in G, and I'm going to take a U in G, and I'm going to explain what kind of U. And you will like this because this is going to be very much connected with complexity. I'm going to take U in G, and I'm going to take F in continuous function, maybe compact support in G mod gamma. So this is how I'm going to make my sequence. F, as always, so the flow is T G gamma X goes to gamma X times G. So it's identical to the null definition, except I have to put a condition on G. Sorry, I was calling it U for a good reason. So I take a point U in G. All right. Now, we have to first know about the entropy of this system. Sorry, TU, thank you. Okay, thank you. So the matrix U, U is a fixed transformation, just like it was then. We're going to take powers of that matrix. If U has eigenvalue, any eigenvalue bigger than 1, so the determinant of the matrix is 1. If U has an eigenvalue bigger than 1, then the system has positive entropy in every sense of the word. This is your classic example of a, what do they call it? I don't know, a Bernoulli transformation on a homogeneous space. So if U has eigenvalue bigger than 1, the conjecture is not, and here I can prove it's not true. I can find points which will correlate with Möbius. I can find points in this case. I don't need Weiss's lemma. It's quite easy. Because these are shifts of finite type, as they call
them. Not because it understands about points, but because it can.
I would do anything. I can find inside there anything I want. Exactly. Very important. So there's only one case where there's a chance that, well, there's only one case where this has zero entropy, and that zero entropy is completely equivalent to U being a unipotent transformation. All its eigenvalues, maybe not diagonalizable, but all its eigenvalues are 1. So U is unipotent. You see, in the nullpotent case, every matrix was automatically of this nature because the whole group had that property. Now I'm only allowed to look at unipotent elements. So the case that Ubers and I are looking at is something like this, the matrix 1U, 1N01 times G times gamma. And this is invertible in this case, so we could put N in Z. This is a very interesting case. Okay, now I claim this is zero entropy, so this is not hard to see. So what entropy does in this kind of smooth dynamics is you look at how orbits move locally away from each other. If they exponentially grow apart, then you'll have positive entropy. And if they only grow polynomially apart, then you'll have zero entropy. And of course, that's the whole point about a unipotent matrix. Its powers are polynomials in the entries in any dimension. So that's the polynomial growth that's critical to give zero entropy. So these are trivially zero entropy. They are much more complicated. So this system is infinitely more complicated than a distal system because, and I want to clarify this, and it's the first time you'll be facing a genuinely serious zero entropy system which you're trying to show is orthogonal, does not correlate with Möbius. because this system is mixing of all orders. So it's statistically very complicated. If you put a measure, a natural measure that's mixing of all orders, it's topologically mixing, while the distal flow and anything that's been considered before is not mixing. So whatever mixing is, that's the next measure of complexity of dynamics. B just n. Yeah, right, right. It's 1, 1 to the n. U is 1, 1. So U is 1, 1, 0. N. In this simple case, it's n. And if you're in higher dimensions, it'll be a polynomial. Okay, now in this setting, there's a fantastic theorem of Ratner. And it gives you some hope that you can attack this problem. But Ratner's theorem is ineffective, which means that we can't do anything on this. Using Ratner, Ratner's theorem will say that every orbit, remember I'm talking about every orbit, and I will now explain what Vinogradov's method is in 5 minutes, just roughly, and what it has to do with dynamics, but every orbit is equidistributed with respect to a homogeneous measure. That's Ratner's famous theorem. So these orbits are not complicated. They have to be quite simple. The trouble in Ratner's work is it's entirely ineffective in general. Now, this particular case can be made effective. This is what Ubers and I have done. We've effectivized what's, in this case, is called Danis' theorem. We've made it completely effective in order to execute a Vinogradov argument. But there's two parts to a Vinogradov argument, and this is where we are not able to prove the conjecture for the system. We are only able to prove weaker things. Let me say a word about what Vinogradov's method is. And how it really has something to do with the dynamics. And if you want to apply Vinogradov's method, you are forced to understand something about the dynamics, something quite deep about the dynamics. So Vinogradov, without going into his sieve, and his the key word is Vinogradov, and there are beautiful treatments by Vaughan, Kowalski, and Ivanich, Heath Brown, many, many treatments of these in the literature, which improve, make smoother, but they're all the same idea. And it's based on the following, that if you want to sum, so I haven't done much with Mobius yet. If you want to sum Mobius against xi of n, and you want to try control something like this, as he did when this was e to the 2 pi I in xi, or e to the 2 pi n squared xi, which is just a shifted torus case. So all the known cases fit into this language. Everything was always in a dynamical language, in a way. What you need are to control sums which involve your low complexity sequence. So Vinogradov's method converts this by a sieve to a straightforward sum, type 1 sum, concerning the distribution in our dynamics, in this case, the distribution. So xi of n is f of t to the n of x. So we'll need to know what's going on with that for every continuous. So we need to really have a good control, and that's what Ratner is saying in principle is true in these cases. Oh, these all zero. I said they were all zero entropy. I've been wanting to say this. These sequences that you construct in this system are in polynomial or polynomial sequences in real complexity. So if you take this model, that's garbage. Yeah. So if you do exact real, then actually you can repeatedly square. So this is interesting. Suppose I have a positive, suppose G here had eigenvalues bigger than 1. Okay, suppose the matrix G was 2, 1, 1, 1, Zaev Rudnick's favorite matrix. The cat map. Suppose you take powers of this acting here or on the torus, doesn't matter. And you can multiply instantly real numbers.
You can do binomial coefficients and factor.
But you have a real number, and any two multiplication of real number, no matter how long the digit is, instantly done, which is apparently what, the Smail model?
You don't need the Smail model. For you, it's okay to work with integers.
No, but I'm trying to say I choose x naught in the torus. So the x naught is a real number. So, of course, I can then compute f of t to the n x very quickly if I can, because I can repeatedly square. And if every operation is exactly computed, that I can compute in polynomial time in that model. But that, so that'll mean that I have positive entropy and my sequence is, in this real model, is computable in polynomial time, which is crazy to me, and of course violates. Right, so it means, I don't understand that model. So there's another model where you're only allowed to do things, you only know numbers up to an accuracy of the number of digits. So there's two errors you're making. And then if your eigenvalue is bigger than one, you'll quickly see that these are not computable quickly. But if you're unipotent, you are in polynomial class for these. So the most important, in my view, examples of where you want to prove this conjecture are these unipotent flows, these homogeneous zero entropy flows. And for all of those, it is the case that in this model, they are all polynomials. They are sequences which are in the polynomial class, and they're supposed to cancel against Mobius. So everything's correct there. Good. Okay, so all very briefly, what Vinogradov's idea is he reduces this. I won't go through the sieve. Just let me say what he reduces this to: two kinds of sums. That is that you have a sum n up to x of f of t to the n, n up to n, t to the n d. So you'll have, maybe you replace t by t to the n d. So you're going on steps of length d, where d will be allowed to be growing with n, like some small power. That's important. X naught, our starting point. So Vinogradov says, if you can understand what this looks, what this should look like, maybe the integral of f, maybe the integral of f is zero, then that should cancel. You should understand the cancellation in this for d up to, for d less than or equal to d. There's a version where you sum on this. And d, you want to be n to the alpha, say. So the kind of control you need is sums on progressions, which is just the dynamics of t to the d, which is not normally studied. But of course, I'm doing this with Ubers. And
so this should be the low n by itself.
Yes.
This is just a statement
right
about c.
Right. So there's a main term, which you usually, if the function were constant, then you'd have a main term. Or if there's some other reason that the function's constant, the remainder should be smaller. So you know the equidistribution quantitatively up to some power like this, but you must allow steps of size d. This is absolutely critical. So it's a purely dynamical question about the equidistribution of orbits. However, in any kind of sieve, this is always sums on progressions must be understood and handsomely. That's where all the expander stuff comes in this affine sieve. But to actually control something like Mobius, Vinogradov's brilliant idea was to set up the sieve so that on some other part of the analysis, he doesn't know what Mobius is, and he will treat it as arbitrary coefficients, and he will estimate the norm of a matrix. It's a really ingenious idea. And for that, he needs type 2 sums, as they are commonly called. And that really involves the dynamics on the dynamical system cross itself. So this involves the square of the system only of f. In other words, you have a d1 and d2, and you have a level of distribution, meaning how big you can choose d1 and d2, and you'll have a sum, and you have a continuous function on xf cross xf. But this is just a new dynamical system, which when you or a null manifold or a distal thing, that's just a new distal thing. So you don't jump out of the category. So it's not hard. And you have to sum f of t to the n d1 x naught in the second component. Same n, t to the n d2 y naught. Say, I free the variables and you can take an arbitrary function. N up to n. And understand the same question as before, but on the product. And here you might have a different distribution, n to the beta. In other words, you can choose d1 and max d1 and d2 going up to n to the beta. So these are called the level of distribution of type 1 sum and type 2 sum. Further powers? No. Not only that. No, they only, to get Mobius, you need, for example, if alpha is 1/2, Liu has optimized this, Beta should be 1/3, was it?
Yeah.
1/3. So it's not only that you need this to be just positive. If you can choose alpha very near 1, then beta can be arbitrarily small. So there they are, these pairs that you have to pass a certain quality of a sieve, and that is all thrown onto the dynamics. Now, in the null case, this is not a serious issue. These things, alpha can be chosen to be arbitrarily close to 1. The product is not a new story. But this is where this becomes really hard. Without having an effective retina.
I have a question about that.
Yeah.
Once you deal with these two types, of, you get cancellation not just against Möbius, but against what?
Now, only Möbius. Yeah, you can get sums on primes and sums on Möbius. There's a sieve. This reduction is for Möbius. And some other functions, lambda. You can do a few functions. Multiplicative of some property. But Möbius is sort of the challenge. Okay, so my point, however, is that this is a purely dynamical question now on the product. And this is where Ubis and I hit a problem and haven't really recovered. Maybe he has, I haven't. So we have a weaker result. And that's when you take SL to R. So, of course, I told you that Ratner is ineffective. So you can't, just knowing that things are equidistributed won't help you in anything like this. So we made effective this case. So we could handle the type 1 sum all the way up to a half, which is the best you can ever hope for. And that's sort of equivalent to full Ramanujan. And we have that unconditionally. And that would require the second sum to be about up to 1/3. But unfortunately, the second sum we can only get at 1/6 right now, even assuming Ramanujan. It's a bit around, where is he? Is he here? Oh, yeah. Well, I can't remember the exact exponent, but it's not in the ballpark. So we can't handle this kind of thing on the product. And anyway, if it's two generic points in the product, it's in fact, we're not even near that case. So the minute you take the square, you're now looking at a very thin orbit inside a bigger space, and the kind of techniques that are very effective, the harmonic analysis techniques, fall a little flat. So we've only able to get something quite a bit weaker then. All right, so let me end. I meant to actually describe these systems with Furstenberg, and let me define now the Möbius system, and a system that we can understand very easily. And it allows me to prove that Möbius is random. So there's one part here that I've been keeping in my pocket. It's a lovely cheat, but it's a kind of cheat that I like. And that's the following. So I'm going to define the Möbius flow. So this looks like tautology, but the minute you can prove something about it, you start to believe in it a little bit. So I think this is the main thrust. Each time you prove something about this, you'll learn something about this Möbius flow. So this Möbius flow is just going to be the smallest system in which I can realize a Möbius function. So I'm going to look at minus 1, 0, 1 to the n. That's my space x, f. So I'm defining, or mf, fm. I don't know what my notation is anymore. X, m, the space. T is a shift. Excuse me, this is not the space. This is omega, these all sequences. Let's take the closure of omega, which is the sequence mu1, mu2, and so on, inside omega 3. I don't know, I mean, I know what to expect here. I can prove very little as to what the set looks like, but let's take that closure, and that will be called M. That'll be called, what is my notation for the set now? XM, thank you, M. And with a transformation. So this is the flow M. That's called the Möbius flow. So it's just the closure in the space of sequences of the Möbius sequence. Okay, it's the simplest system in which Möbius will live. I claim it's got positive entropy. And all the theorems that we're proving here of this type are really disjointness theorems about this system with zero entropy systems in the language of Furstenberg. Okay, what can we say about this? Everything I can say about that comes from the following, and this is all I know about this, is that this system has a factor. M has a factor which gives me a lot of information. So let me define the square free factor. And the reason here is solving for square free numbers is much easier than solving for Mobius, and this can actually be executed. And so I'm going to get all the randomness from Mobius by cheating. I'm going to get it from the zeros and the ones and not from the minus one and the ones. But that certainly is legitimate. And this happens to be a fantastically interesting dynamical system. It's very unusual. It's not homogeneous. It's nothing that looks like anything that I think anybody's seen before. And I pretty much know everything about it. So let's consider 0, 1 to the n. So omega 2. And let me consider the point mu 1 squared, mu 2 squared, which are now just the square free numbers. I'll call it xi inside omega 2. And let me close this up. So the closure under the shift, closure of t to the n xi, closure of the set equals xs, the space for the square free flow. Now, the philosophy of understanding a dynamical system like this is very much like with groups. If you can find a complicated factor of a group, you can say something about the group. So I'm going to find a complicated factor of the Mobius flow, and it'll tell me something about the flow itself. So a factor means this. I have my transformation from M to M, which is the shift. I have my transformation from S to S, which is the shift also. I use the same notation. I have a map, a continuous map here, which I get the same answer if I go that way or that way. And this map here is just x, which is a continuous function. If x is in M, then x goes to x squared. Let me give this a name, phi. Goes to just square each coordinate. Perfectly good map. It'll take me from the point xi to the point, from the Mobius point, which are called omega, to the point xi. And you think about it, it'll take me from M onto S. And this, so this realizes S is a factor of M. So this is useful if I know something about S. But I do know everything about S, so to speak. So I'll state that with a theorem. And then the main theorem, which was that Mobius is random, will follow from the fact that the topological entropy of S is positive. So the topological entropy cannot be lost on taking a factor. It's just, but I don't know that there's any more entropy to Mobius, which is extremely frustrating. I'm sure it's true, but that, of course, only way I can see how to get my hands on Mobius is to prove more of the main conjecture for different Fs. More or less, if a version of this conjecture, a relative version of this, if it's true, would imply that Mobius has more entropy if you knew the full conjecture. So this conjecture is really telling you more and more about the randomness of Mobius. Right now I'm getting all the randomness from the square free factor, and so let me state the theorem. All right, I'm running out of time, but let me just say it in words.
We allow over time.
Okay, right, let me state the theorem. So S, the square free factor, S satisfies the following. H of S is 6 over pi squared, a number that you've seen, times log 2. Secondly, okay, I won't write down the dynamic properties. It's proximal. Not mixing. I know a tremendous amount about the square free factor, all coming from executing a square free sieve and getting a very beautiful answer. Three, and this is important, S itself is trying to have a Kronecker factor. S has a joining, it's not disjoint from. S has a joining. That's what Glasner's book is called, joinings. S has a joining, which I'll end by saying what I mean, with a certain flow, which has got something to do with square free numbers, with the Kronecker flow, K, which is the group, So it's a compact group product Z mod P squared Z, product of all primes. So that's a compact product of finite groups. It's an infinite compact group with the operation T of X is X goes, it's got a topological generator, this X goes to X plus 1 in each coordinate, the generator of each local piece. That's a ergodic Kronecker flow. And S has a joining. It doesn't have a factor. It's trying to have this as a factor. So this has got the positive entropy. That gives the positive entropy of mu. I don't have time to explain why a square-free sieve is more elementary, but all the difficult part is actually understanding the answer after you execute the sieve. And what's very important here, and this is really nice, is this is itself like whenever you prove something is topologically dense, which is what you're proving here, you're identifying what this closure is, you usually in this game, at least in our game, can prove something better. It's much easier to prove Kronecker's theorem, which is the equidistribution of points in a torus by the density of the points by proving they're equidistributed. And the same is true here. So there's a measure, so theorem two. There's a measure nu. It's quite complicated. I've got a very complicated formula for it. It's been the hardest part to handle it. That's where the hardest work is. There's a nu invariant measure, a t invariant measure on the square free flow, such that one, it's interest to me, there are many invariant measures. The point xi is generic for that measure. In other words, the orbit of that point is equidistributed with respect to a measure that I know on this infinite product space, such that xi is t to the n xi in the ordinary sense. So these are points inside the space. Of course, this is what you will need when you try and understand anything. It's equidistributed with respect to nu in our space xs. With respect to that measure, against continuous functions, of course. Two, and this is a shocking thing, the measure entropy of this process is zero. It's deterministic, and I can even tell you how to recover the first coordinate from the other coordinates with probability one. It's completely deterministic, so h nu is zero. So the measure theoretic square free flow is deterministic, which is quite nice. Three, S nu has this process with Haar measure as K nu as a factor, and I think this is it's the biggest abelian factor. So I know the square free guy inside out, let's say. More or less. There's a measure of maximal entropy, which a student of mine is working on. I think they'll have that soon. And so that's a system we know only because I'm able to. So let me fess up, as they say. Only because I can compute, and it's not difficult, the analog of Chandler's theorem for square free. And there's a theorem that just to do that is very easy. I think Wintner was the first to do that. But the answer in these terms of trying to understand these issues like entropy, I find very tricky. And zero, the most important, S nu is ergodic. That's a beautiful property of a system that you first look for. And that, I thought, would be trivial. Again, there's not a homogeneous system. So we understand the square-free flow. That should give some information, and all the information that's cheap that I know about M comes from this. All the other information comes from known cases of that conjecture. Let me end, since Michael Eisenman and Tom Spencer are here, with a problem that measures the randomness of Mobius that Bergen and I are looking at, but we haven't got the maximum out of it, which is why I've kept quiet. But last time I gave his lecture, he complained that I didn't mention this, so I will mention it now in it. Suppose you take the random Schrodinger operator. That's what these guys like. So how random is Mobius? So let's take un plus 1 plus un minus 1 plus mu of n, u of n equal to 0. That's the operator. H of u. So this is for sequence, say, in little L2 of the positive integers, and you put a boundary condition, I don't know, U of 1 equals 0, whatever, you need to make it self-adjoint. So it's, you've isolated it on the one end because it's a one-sided line. All right, and you ask about what is the spectrum of this operator? So if this were a random, genuinely random sequence, it's a fantastic theorem. Again, follows by a work of Furstenberg. Furstenberg seems to have entered in every aspect of this, in this one-dimensional case, that with probability 1, so for random mu, this has pure point spectrum. The eigenfunctions are all square integral localized. They dense in an interval minus 2, 2. So we would all bet that it's true for Mobius, that the spectrum's pure point. So we don't have a proof of that yet. We can only prove that there's, I think there's no absolutely continuous spectrum. No, but I'm not taking any random addition here. I'm not taking an arbitrary point to shift in the space. I'm taking mu of n itself.
See, it's not an ergodic system.
I don't know. Yeah, this is
a
statement about Mobius. And it's sort of a test of how much you know about Mobius that you can't prove something that it's random enough to create point spectrum. But we can say something highly non-trivial. The goal would be to show there's pure point spectrum. So that's a measure, another measure of the randomness of Mobius, which, yeah. All right, I think I better stop. Yeah, we've gone over time. Yeah, I had more to say, but I have anybody.